Okay. Sure. That's okay. Yeah, I kind of doubt how many implications for practice there are because it's a conceptual paper, but we'll see what. Grounds. Good to hear. You convinced me. Sure. My name is Ruben van Werven. I'm at the moment a PhD student at VU University in Amsterdam. I'm in my final year now, so I'm hoping that I'll finish my dissertation in August. And my work is on, well, entrepreneurship, specifically how new venture founders convince other people of their idea. Yeah, related to this, we started this project because I was interested in how new venture founders acquire resources for their firm. As we all know, and as has been said a lot, new ventures are risky investment opportunities. There's not a lot of evidence to share with other people to make it to convince them that it will bring returns on their investment. So I was really interested in this idea. And so I started, that was the main question of my PhD project, so to say. So I started reading up on the topic and found that often you see that what these entrepreneurs need is legitimacy. So people have to understand their idea, and that often occurs when they have received an endorsement from a celebrity entrepreneur or their first client, or when their firm looks like existing firms. But then I thought, okay, so they need this legitimacy, but how do they establish that? How do they convince other people that they are legitimate? This evidence is there, but they have to communicate it in order for other people to believe them. So I started to get more interested in the communication aspect. So how do people establish this legitimacy when they are talking to someone else? And related to that, also, a new firm should not just be legitimate, similar to another firm, but it should also have like a distinctive edge. It should be new. It should be interesting to invest in. So then I started looking at how entrepreneurs can, well, convince their audience that they are both legitimate and distinct. And I thought this communication aspect, this how do they establish legitimate distinctiveness, had not been researched a lot. So that's the main motivation for this paper. Yeah, when I decided I wanted to look at the communication of entrepreneurs and how they establish legitimate distinctiveness, I started to read previous research on how entrepreneurs communicate with an audience. So it could be an investor or a customer or employees. And then I saw that most of those studies, they looked at how entrepreneurs use analogies. So like my firm is the Airbnb for, well, insert industry. And based on what I knew from argumentation theories, there are many, many more arguments that people use when they are talking to someone, when they try to persuade them. So I started looking at other entrepreneurship studies, previous research, mostly qualitative studies, and started looking at the evidence that they presented in their paper. So quotes that entrepreneurs had actually told them, things they said during interviews or pitches, and seeing if in those quotes, so in those data that other researchers gathered, I could find other arguments than analogies. And so I kind of used that as my source of data and found that, yeah, indeed, there are several more argument types than just analogies. In fact, we found six types of arguments in those other papers. So that's the main approach. We looked at previous research. We studied those excerpts and with this argumentation theories in the back of our minds, and identified the types of arguments that were there and used that as the basis for a framework of arguments that entrepreneurs can use to convince other people of the legitimate distinctiveness of their business. Sure, I can. One is, as I just... Yeah. So we have six types of arguments in our framework of argumentation. One is, as I just mentioned, the argument by analogy. So an entrepreneur can compare his or her venture to another venture to make it either legitimate or distinct. So if you want to be seen as legitimate, you can compare your venture to a very well-known other business so that people at least know what you're related to and stress the similarities. And if you want to be seen as innovative and you're in an industry that is quite conservative, you can draw an analogy to a very innovative firm from another industry to stress your distinctive potential. So that's the first type of argument that we found. Another one is the argument from sign. So you can, as an entrepreneur, say that there is a certain characteristic of your venture or of your founding team that is, well, a manifestation of something bigger. So the potential of this venture to change an industry or to create a new industry, or if you want to look at it more from a legitimating perspective, that there are signs that the venture is similar or legitimate. Another argument would be the argument by classification. A classification argument is an argument that applies a general rule to a specific case. So if there's a general rule about, say, ventures in the automotive industry, and you manage to apply that to your specific case, then your audience can believe like, okay, this venture belongs to that industry, and this gives it some sense of legitimacy. And you can do a similar thing with this argument to stress the distinctive potential. Then there is the argument by cause. An entrepreneur can specify certain effects of his or her actions or the actions of the firm. And those can be legitimating, like, okay, we are a venture and we'll probably generate profits and a good return on your investments if you're a business venture. But suppose an entrepreneur was one of the first social entrepreneurs and specified the effects of their business that would benefit society in general and not just investors or banks. Then the effects could be a distinctive aspect of that firm. And now let me think of the others. We also identified an argument by generalization. That's the classic inductive argument. So there is some evidence, and based on that evidence, you draw a general conclusion. So an entrepreneur could do that when they don't have any results yet, not customers, because we are focusing on new venture founders, nascent entrepreneurs. So if they have done some prototype testing, so they tested their minimum viable product, say that, in the market with some of their friends, and those initial results were positive, and then they can just translate those initial results and say, like, okay, so we are confident that our product will work, that customers will like that when we bring it to the market. And then finally, the sixth argument, there's the argument from authority. And in those types of arguments, entrepreneurs and people in general don't rely on evidence that they gathered or statements that are commonsensical, but they use themselves to ground their statements. So, well, I have experience as an entrepreneur. I have started this successful venture previously, so I'm confident that this venture will also be successful. And that type of argument can also be used to emphasize that the venture is legitimate or distinctive, and ideally a combination of the two. And those were the six arguments in our framework. How entrepreneurs can use the framework to I think entrepreneurs can use our framework of six arguments to take another look at their pitch. If they have come up with a presentation to investors and they want to check if their pitch is convincing or persuasive, obviously practicing helps a lot, testing it with people that you already know. But I think our framework can also be used as a lens to study a pitch. You can ask yourself, okay, I'm saying that I have experience as a teacher, and I'm based on that, I'm claiming that I'm the right person to build this venture. Is that experience as a teacher, is that really a sign that I'm going to be a good entrepreneur? Investors may doubt that, and if you're looking at the pitch with this framework in the back of your mind, you may also reconsider a statement like that. And same, I think, applies for the other types of arguments. If you're saying, I'm the Airbnb for 3D printing, is that an analogy that makes sense? Can the business model of Airbnb be copied to the 3D printing industry? Is that a plausible claim? I think that's a way to check a pitch and see if it's persuasive. Yeah, I've seen that paper. Yeah. Grams, yeah. Yeah, they can reflect on their own business using these, yeah, pretending to be an investor and looking at their own presentations through their eyes, you're saying. Yeah. Yeah, I guess you're right. I never thought of it that way. Sounds great. Thank you.